Hello and welcome back, folks. My name is Bruce. I'm very excited to bring you all lesson number 9 of our fall quarter. And our lesson today is entitled Joshua's Final Exhortation. And it comes to us from Joshua chapter 24, verses 1 and then verses 14 through 24. Time of writing is about 1390 BC. The place is Shechem. The golden text is, if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Joshua 24 and verse 15. And this is one of those verses in scripture that is well known, right? Those of you who've been walking with the Lord for any amount of time, you've read that or you've heard that spoken in your ears. And it is truly powerful. As I think back when we first joined our church, one of the sermons that stuck out to me didn't necessarily come from our pastor. It came from his father, Elder Ben Holloman, right? And he had said it once in a setting, and he said that he decided that as for him and his house, they were going to serve the Lord. And then he brought a sermon on that same topic. And what I truly love about men and women of God who are leaders of their households, who make the stand, that's the bold stand that says, I don't care what the world does. I don't care what they do. But what we're going to do in this house, or we're going to serve the Lord. And so as my thoughts and prayers go to Elder Holloman right now, he's dealing with a little deal in his body, so please pray for him. But again, this was his statement, if you will. And as I think about it, you know, there are a lot of men like him who made the decision. A lot of men and women like him that made the decision. And you see, well, from those godly men and women, well, they produce fruit, right, in the form of their children, right. And you see the grandchildren in the case of Elder Holloman. His son is our pastor. His daughters have worked in the ministry. Excuse me. His grandsons, grandchildren are currently working in the ministry. That is an example of, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And so as we get into that lesson, prayerfully, I can make that plain. Prayerfully, you guys are having a great start of your week and you had a great weekend. And again, may we all take these practical points and apply them into our daily lives. And again, as we get into this lesson, Joshua is about to leave the scene. He is getting up in age. It is time for him to go and be with the ancestors, if you will. And so he is going back to the people and he's saying, okay, guys, you know, you're doing some funny stuff right now. You know, there's coming a time where you guys are going to have to make a choice, right? You can't serve both. You're going to have to make a choice. And so we see him going to the people and we see their response to what he said. And we'll get into that as we get in the lesson. I don't want to run ahead of my notes, but again, prayerfully, this lesson reaches you in a good place and the Holy Spirit will use me to make this lesson plain and you can apply it again into your daily lives. And so as we look at the purpose of our lesson today, to show how a courageous man of integrity who knew the right thing to do and was not afraid to do it regardless of what anyone else might do. And again, as we live in a world, right, that constantly tells you that you have to be politically correct. You can't say different things. And again, you can say all things if you say it in love, right? But we live in a world where, you know, you get crushed, so to speak, sometimes when you stand on the word of God, right? Joshua declared his faith in spite of what others might do or say. He was not influenced by popular opinion, right? And again, we see that today where people won't say certain things in scripture because they don't want to upset people. They don't want people to stop coming. They don't want people to stop giving to the collection plate. So they hold back and they don't say certain things or they run with whatever is popular, like politicians. Joshua had a long and distinguished career at Kadesh Barnea He demonstrated his faith in God by being one of only two spies to return a positive report. During the wilderness wanderings, he was the commander of the Israelite armed forces. When Moses died, God chose Joshua to be the new leader of the Israelite nation. Under Joshua's leadership, the Israelites invaded the land of promise and carried out a successful conquest of the land. Now Joshua knew the end was near. He knew the time was approaching, when he would have to pass the baton of leadership to the next generation of leaders, right? Joshua assembled the leaders of the nation and urged them to be faithful to God and the covenant he made with them. Pagan religious influences from Mesopotamia, Egypt, and Canaan were spiritual threats that needed to be forcefully resisted. And again, while we don't deal with those idol gods from those places, we still have, in some cases, set up idols in our lives, and we have to resist them with everything that we have. Joshua animately called upon the Israelites to make a clear choice. They could choose to serve Yahweh exclusively, or they could turn to polytheism. For those of you who don't know, that is the belief in or worship of more than one God. But they could not have it both ways, right? The people readily agreed to serve the Lord only. And again, you have to be careful now, because there's receipts, right? And he told them, these very words that you all are speaking, these very words will come back and bite you, right? Today's aim, facts, to study how the covenant was renewed under the leadership of Joshua. Because again, remember, when Moses was in charge, the people had all came together and they said everything. They got a little beside themselves. They wanted God to come down. God was like, okay, tell them to clean the camp, and I'm coming. And he was a distance away, and they got scared, right? And so they said, no, Moses, you go talk to him. Moses goes and talks to him. God says everything. And they say, yeah, we'll do everything he says. Just keep him over there. But we'll do everything he says. So that was then. Now Joshua is about to leave the scene. And he's like, okay, guys, y'all remember, some of you all were around when your parents entered into this covenant, right? And so now, as you all are adults and have your own families, now we're going to renew it, right? The principle is to show that it is right to follow only the Lord our God and serve him alone. Again, principle is to show that it is right to follow only the Lord our God and serve him alone. I don't have time for any of these other idols, these other false gods that people like to set up, right? I only have enough energy for the true and living God. Application for our lesson is to demonstrate that as Christians, we are called to follow only our God and only our God. In a pluralistic society where false gods may seek to lure us away, right? Money, cars, homes, relationships, jobs. Again, whatever you can set up, whatever you can put in front of God is an idol, right? And in some cases, it's a god. And it will pull you away from the true and living God. You'll find yourself not going to church as much as you used to, not reading your Bible as much as you used to, not praying as much as you used to, because you're too busy trying to get to whatever it is, your job or counting your money or washing your car or spending time with your spouse, right? You have to be very careful with those things sometimes. During the point in Israel's history, God's people needed a reminder, and not necessarily a gentle one. Israel had forgotten the demands of their covenant relationship with God. In Israel's case, memory was not the problem. The problem was sinful hearts, right? Because again, your flesh wants what your flesh wants. And if you don't control your flesh, well, it will control you. In this week's lesson, we discover how a godly man named Joshua was used by the Lord to remind his people about their accountability to their God, and how God's people responded to Joshua's challenge. As we look at the age group emphasis for my young people, we want to understand that he's his faithful character, right? So youthful transgressions often lead to a life of despair. Like sometimes you get in trouble as a kid and you stay there. You never find your way out of it. And even in your adult life, you're still plagued by some of these transgressions, right? But listen here, young people. God never gives up on his people. He never gives up on his covenant promises, right? So if you belong to him, he's not going to give up on you. He'll wait until you're ready, but he's not going to give up on you. And will always welcome his repentant children back into his presence with open arms. So the moment you say, okay, God, you know, I messed up. This is my fault. Forgive me for the sin and restore me. Well, it's nothing. It's already done. For the adults, we want to understand that it is never too late to echo Joshua's godly announcement. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I don't care where you are. You can say it right now. If you haven't pronounced that over your house, you can say it right now. As for me and my house, again, the world can do what the world wants to do. You can do what you want to do. You can do what you want to do. But right here in this house, we serve the Lord. We don't serve Hindu gods. We don't serve Egyptian gods. We don't serve none of that Scientology. We don't none of that mess, none of that crap. We serve the one true God here. And I hope it's the same where you stay. Before we get into the lesson, like last week, we had a question for you guys to discuss amongst yourselves, for you to jump down in the comment section and give me your thoughts, or just to have conversations with your coworkers or even in your own Sunday school. And I enjoyed the feedback that I got from last week's questions. Shout out to Jay Ross and Jane Walker. I couldn't agree more with you two, with you all's takes, right? It is. It is unfortunate that we put aside God to attempt to make our own moves, even though God has never let us down, right? Because again, as they each said in their own way, we tend to do what we want to do, right? We think that we got it, or you put on, and then when you're exposed, it just completely turns the next person off to where they're like, you know, I don't even want to be bothered with that. If that's a Christian, I don't want to be bothered with that. So again, we as Christians have to make sure that we are the example. For this week, the question for you all to discuss amongst yourselves or jump into the comment section and give me your thoughts. Many Israelites were still holding on to idols in Joshua's day, which is, again, strange. And we'll get into that when we get into the lesson. What lessons can we learn from this? And what idols might we be holding on to? Again, many Israelites were still holding on to idols in Joshua's day, right? What lessons can we learn from this, and what idols might we be holding on to? So please, if you will, jump down in the comment section and give me your thoughts on that, or just amongst yourselves, or even in your Sunday school on this Sunday. Again, a little bit about Shechem before we get into our verses. Well, actually, let's get into our verse. Joshua 24, verse 1, and Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and called for the elders of Israel and for their heads and for their judges and for their officers. And they presented themselves before God. Right. So now Joshua is knowing that his time is coming. And so he wants to gather the leaders again. You know, when we hear, you know, when you hear they get again, it's just the leaders, right? The most important people from every tribe, right? And so he's called these men together so that they can come and present themselves before God, because he has a message from God to give to them. Verse 14. Excuse me. And before we jump into 14, let's look at a little bit about Shechem. It is the modern Tel Balata. This ancient city was situated on the floor of a valley near its entrance, Mount Gerizim and Mount Ebal, forming their respective walls. The contour of the land resulted in a natural amphitheater, the acoustics of which were so good that the human voice carried to exceptional distances, right? So you can imagine that this was a perfect place to gather a large group of people, even though it's not the entire nation of Israel, but to gather a large group and where everyone can hear no matter where they're standing, right? So Shechem was a place of rich history also for Israel. There were at least four notable events there in the lives of the patriarchs. In the first two instances, we see Shechem as a place of calling and commitment. In the second two, we see Shechem as a place of shame, right? Abraham came into the promised land and first camped at Shechem. There, God appeared to Abraham and confirmed his promise. Abraham built an altar to the Lord there, Genesis 12, 6 through 7. When Jacob came back into the promised land, he first camped at Shechem. He purchased land at Shechem and built an altar there, calling the place El Elohi Israel. That is translated God, the God of Israel. Genesis 33, 16 through verse 20. Jacob's sons, Simeon and Levi, deceptively lured the men of Shechem into a massacre, murdering all the men of the city. Genesis chapter 34. And just briefly in that story, for those of you who aren't familiar, the one of the men in the town violated their sister, Dana or Dinah, however you want to pronounce it. But he fell in love with her and wanted to marry her. And long story long, they said, if you do this, then we will accept it. Well, again, as they were on the mend from doing what they asked them to do, they came in and put all the men in that town to death and took their sister and took her back home. Right. In the season of recommitment to God in Jacob's life, God told him to go to Bethel. Jacob did so and commanded all in his household to put away their idols. Jacob took those idols and buried them at the Tenebroth tree near Shechem. Genesis 35 verses 1 through 5. So again, you see that city had a lot, had a lot going on. Joshua 24 and before we jump there, verse 14. Now, therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. So again, he's saying, OK, now, therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity. Be genuine. Don't be fake. Don't be half in, half out. Don't, because again, you can't play with God like that anyway, right? Because God looks at our heart. So you may think that, you know, you're getting over, and you may think that, oh man, you know, you got this elegant speech and, you know, you're slick with your tongue. That may work on man. That doesn't work on God, right? So again, serve him in sincerity. That means don't put anybody before him. That means don't prostrate yourself. Right. Don't prostitute yourself to these idols, to these other people, because you're looking at them and wanting to be like them. Right. And put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood. Right. And so, you know, you can look at it from one or two ways if you wanted to. But more than likely, this is talking about when they came across the Jordan River. Right. So as they were in the wilderness and dealing with all of that stuff that kept coming up over and over and over and over and over and over and over again, right? Again, them wanting to go back into Egypt because, again, leeks and onions and all this other stuff, them making a golden calf because they wanted to worship something that they made with their own hands, right? He's like, don't be like them, right? I saved them from that. So don't y'all fall in the same trap that they fell into, right? Serve ye the Lord. Listen, I know y'all know the stories, right? I know y'all know because it was passed down. Your ancestors, parents and grandparents crossed over the Red Sea on dry ground. And the Egyptian army was in hot pursuit and they all died right there in that ocean. We got over here, right? We crossed the Red Sea. Now we're in the wilderness. Now we're hungry. He provides. We're thirsty. He provides. It's hot. He provides cover. We need light. He provides light. He did everything for them. Right. So, and again, you, when you see verse 14, it's like, well, why would they not serve him sincerely with sincerity? Because, again, just look at what he did. Same thing for us. Just look back over your life and see what he did for you. What Red Sea did he bring you through? What wall of Jericho did he tear down for you? Right. So, again, we don't have. Show me where your money bailed you out. And I understand. Right. What I'm talking about. Sure, you can buy your way out of a situation, but that doesn't mean you're going to find peace. Yeah, you can throw money at it, but that doesn't mean you're going to find happiness. Again, there's a lot of rich people, a lot of people with wealth and all kinds of things, and yet they're unhappy, right? So again, before I go off on a tangent, let's look at the practical point that covers that. At key times in our lives, we are rightly called on to conform our dedication to the Lord. Again, at key times in our lives, we are rightly called on to conform our dedication to the Lord. So again, have you reaffirmed? Right? Because again, you may say, well, that doesn't, why would I have to do that? That doesn't make any sense. Well, miss church a couple Sundays. Don't read your Bible for a week or two. Don't pray for a week or two or three. And find how easy it'll be to slip back into whatever it was that you were doing before you came to the Lord. So again, at key times in your life, hey, God, I'm still here. I'm still down. I'm still 10 toes. I'm still all in. Whatever you want to use, I'm still with you, God. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. As we look at verse 15, and if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. This is Joshua talking to him. Listen, man, if you think that serving the God that did everything that I just laid out into for you all previously, right? If you think that that's evil, well, right, listen. You can choose for you today. You want to serve Horus, you want to serve Anubis, you want to serve these Egyptian gods, huh? You want to serve these Amorite gods that we just got here? And it's just like humans, right? Just like humans. Despite all of the positive things that God did, we just thought, no, man, no. Yeah, man, I don't, no, man. Let me run back to this money. Yeah, let me run back to this bad relationship, you know, where I was mentally or physically abused, where I wasn't happy. Let me run back to that, right? Yeah, you brought me out of it, but yeah, you know what? Listen, you know. And was it really that bad? You know, man, I think I got it. I think it, this time would be different. And we tell ourselves that, we lie to ourselves. And Satan's like, I got him. I got him. Him and his demon. They're like, yeah, boy, you got him. Yeah, we got him locked in. Right. And before you know it, you just done moved all away. You done moved completely away from God. Now He tossing you to and fro. He doing whatever he want to do with you. Because, again, it wasn't real. Those idols ain't real. You can't pray to your idol. An idol isn't going to intercede on your behalf. An idol isn't going to be of any need when you're sick in the hospital and the doctor says, you got less than 3 months. Yeah, man, this is over for you. It's a wrap. You might as well go home. Ain't nothing I can do for you. You can't go to no golden calf and pray to it and get some type of answer. So again, don't be like those people. Don't be like those people who, again, God has done marvelous things in your life. And all you can think about is, yeah, but, you know, the world. I want to be like the world. Oh, I want to serve them gods. Oh, I want to worship that. I want to put my energy in that. I don't have time for the true and living God. I don't have time for the brothers and sisters of faith. Miss me with all that. Practical point. I'm sorry. Moving so fast. Let's go back up into 14 real fast. Now, therefore, fear the Lord, serve him in sincerity and in truth. This was not a blind leap of faith. They saw God's work and experienced his blessing. So it made sense for them to exclusively serve a God who had done so much for them. Right. Again, serve him in sincerity and truth. Joshua boldly called for a deep commitment and a true commitment. Listen, none of that mouth speak. Right. Don't just say it because you want to placate me and you want to get out of here and get back to doing what you're doing. Because, again, God heard you and he's going to hold you accountable to what you said. As we look at 15. Practical point. If we object to serving the Lord, we will still end up serving someone or something. You can believe that. Again, if we object to serving the Lord, we will still end up serving someone or something, right? Because again, whatever you put in front of God, that's an idol. That's your God. Choose you this day whom ye will serve. Our choice for God is made in a clear mind of the alternatives, right? Some feel a life lived for God is a bad choice, but what do they compare it to? And again, I've been walking with the Lord a while, and I can tell you right now, I've not regretted it one moment. The other choices are far worse. As Peter said, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, John 6:68. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. The English uses a future tense here, but the Hebrew tense has a fuller meaning. It expresses continuous action. It involves the future, but it can also point to the past. Joshua was undoubtedly affirming, I have chosen and I will choose. I have chosen to serve the Lord and I will continuously choose to serve the Lord. No matter what they do, I am going to serve the Lord. Joshua could make this statement because he had lived a life that continuously chose to serve the Lord. Joshua chose to fight against the Amalekites, choosing when it might have cost everything, right? Joshua chose to reject the golden calf, choosing when the flesh might have been satisfied, right? Joshua chose to serve the Lord by serving Moses, choosing a humble place. Joshua chose to believe God's promise about the promised land, choosing against the majority. Joshua chose to recognize the leadership of the captain of the Lord's army, choosing to surrender to God. Joshua chose to take leadership of Israel and lead them into the land, choosing faith instead of unbelief. God gives us choices, everyone. God is a choosing God. We are made in his image, and he wants us to also choose him. All right. Again, it's a free choice. You don't have to, but he certainly wants you to. Joshua's But as for me and my house, the contrasting word but gives a sense that Joshua was determined on this course no matter what anyone else thought. His relationship with God was not based on any man, but on the Lord alone. And he would serve God no matter what anyone else did. And that should be it should be the same for everyone listening to my voice. Don't come to church because someone else went to church. Come to church because you want to give yourself to the Lord. Because again, if you go because someone else went, and if they fall off, well, monkey see, monkey do. You'll fall off right along with them. But if you go again like Joshua, my relationship is built on God, not anything that the next man does. Right. Because I'm not going to be judged for what the next man does. And the next man won't be judged for what I do. So I don't base my relationship on the Lord based on my pastor or the leaders of my church. Right. And it again should be the same for everyone listening to my voice, especially those of you who are children of God. Joshua's decision meant hesitation was gone. Joshua's decision meant he lived above the evil influences of others. Right. Right. So you're not worried about anybody coming in trying to talk you into doing something. You're not hesitant. You know what you know. Right. You are firm in your belief. Joshua's decision was deep, calm, clear, fixed, well grounded and solemnly made. Listen, he didn't go into this irrationally. right? He didn't go into this with eyes closed. He went in with both eyes open. He went in understanding, all right, this is what it is. And I accept everything that is. Joshua's decision was openly made. Listen, right there in front of everybody. He told the whole crowd, listen, I don't care what y'all do. But me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord over here. Joshua's decision was earnestly carried out, right, by his family after he passed, right? Joshua's decision was kept throughout his whole life. So important, right? If you make the stands for God, if you say, I'm with you, I'm. Don't get weary in well-doing. Don't get tired of running your race, right? As we look at verse 16. And the people answered and said, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. Now, isn't that interesting here in 16, right? Oh, God forbid we serve. Listen, they were serving idols in Joshua's day. So for them to say here in 16, oh, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods, when they actively, in some cases, let's not put it all on everybody, but some of them had idols even as right, even as they're going through this period, even after all of the victories, even after everything that God did, they were still serving idols, right? So they say in 16, listen, God forbid. Now we're not gonna worship no other idols. We're only gonna serve the true and living God. Now again, you know that those words would come back and bite them later on. Verse 17. For the Lord our God, he it is that brought us up and our fathers out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage, and which did those great signs in our sight and preserved us all the way wherein we went and among all the people through whom we passed. So they're even acknowledging like, yeah, man, he did bring us out of Egypt when we were slaves. He did take care of us during the wilderness. He has taken care of us as we've come into the promised land and as we've started to subdue it and conquer it. He has done all of that. He has done everything, right? 18. And the Lord drave out from before us all the people, even the Amorites, which dwelt in the land. Therefore, we will also serve the Lord, for he is our God. Again, they're just reaffirming. Again, he got rid of all of these people. He did all of this for us. Listen, we're going to serve him again. And let me backtrack just a little bit. For that immediate generation, that generation right after Joshua, they followed. Everybody that was alive, right, they followed it. Right. Even after Joshua died. But the moment he was gone, that generation that followed, right, after that generation died. It's almost like verse 16 didn't happen. Verse 17 didn't happen. Verse 18 didn't happen. Because they fell so fast and so hard into idol and apostasy that it make your head spin. Verse 19. Before we get to verse 19, practical point number three. Considering all he has done for us, the Lord is certainly worthy of all our considering all he has done for us, the Lord is certainly worthy of our unreserved loyalty. Again, considering all he has done for us, the Lord is certainly worthy of our unreserved loyalty. Again, why would you want to be disloyal to the God that saved you? Why would you want to be disloyal to the God that washed away your sin, that provided the means to wash away your sins? Why would you want to be disloyal to the God when you need something, right? When someone is sick, when it's getting serious, when you're in the middle of the fire, you're in the middle of the storm. Why would you not want to be loyal to the only God that can help you out? Excuse me. Verse 19. And Joshua said unto the people, ye cannot serve the Lord, for he is an holy God. He is a jealous God, and he will not forgive your transgressions nor your sins. And he's like, listen, and when you see that in 19, he's not telling them that they can't serve the Lord. What he's saying is, don't take it lightly. This ain't a game. You can't play with God, right? Again, I told y'all here in 15, again, if you want to serve other gods, go head on and serve other gods. But if you serve him, well, listen, He is a jealous God. He's holy. First of all, he's holy. So you need to have that. We need to deal with that sin before you even come into his presence. That's why we as Christians should thank God for grace, right? That you don't have to sacrifice an animal to wash away your, to cleanse you of your sins before you can go into his presence, right? He is jealous. You think about everything that he's done, everything that he did for the children of Israel. He provided food, water, shelter, protection. He did everything. He did the same thing for you. Maybe not in the manner that he did for the children of Israel, but if you look back over your life, I can guarantee you, you can find situations and you can find times where it was like, yeah, God did that. No, it wasn't nobody else but God. Because if it wasn't for God, I don't know if I'd be standing here right now. I don't know, boy, if it wasn't for the Lord on my side, listen, I don't know where I would be. Straight up. And so again, he will not forgive your transgressions nor your sins. So if you say, I'm all in, God, and you not, judgment is coming. And you're not going to like it. Verse 20. If ye forsake the Lord and serve strange gods, then he will turn and do you hurt and consume you after that he have done you good. Right. So again, y'all say, y'all are saying we will serve the Lord. No, we will not, for God forbid we serve these idols. No, no. He's like, OK, all right, gang, this is what it is now. If ye forsake the Lord and serve strange gods, and we all know that we have the ability of hindsight, right? We know what happened, right? But he's telling them here in 20, if y'all do this, this is what's going to happen. No joke. This is what's going to happen. He will turn and do you hurt. We saw the whole northern kingdom wiped out, completely carried away by the Syrians, never to return. The southern kingdom went into a 70-year captivity period. And that's before that, and later on would be completely expelled. And the temple destroyed. So again, when you make these declarative statements to God, remember, he heard you. The enemy heard you, right? Because he's going to test you too, but God heard you too. And if you switch out on him, might be some problems. Practical point for 19 and 20. A promise to serve God is not something to be taken lightly or frivolously. Again, a promise to serve God is not something that can be taken lightly or frivolously, because again, remember, you've been redeemed. You've been purchased at a cost. It costs to bring you into the family of God. So don't take it lightly. As we jump back up into 19, because I want to read this into you all's hearing, Joshua was not trying to discourage. He's not trying to discourage their faith, but trying to discourage a light commitment to following the Lord. They need to be reminded that they are serving God under a covenant, right? Remember, there was a covenant that promised that they will be cursed for disobedience. Jesus expressed the same kind of warning, explaining that following him took total commitment for you New Testament people. In Luke 14:25-33, it wasn't that Jesus didn't want followers, but he did not want lightly made and easily broken commitments. I'm with you today, God, but as soon as the storm come, oh, no, nah, man, I'm gone. Oh, I'm with you today, God, but no, nah, that fire's too hot. Oh, I'm with you today, God, but oh, they killing. Oh, no, nah, bro. No, not about to die. Not about to die. No. Self-preservation. So it becomes us to speak very reverently and leniently about our ability to obey. We are probably overestimating our powers because, again, what we talked about in previous lessons, I'm grown. You can't tell me nothing. I'm grown. So when God says, I need you to trust and obey, don't say, oh, yeah, God, I got you. Oh, man, I completely obey whatever you tell me to do, God. And then God says, OK, well, quit your job, sell your house and go in the mission field. And you're like, huh? What? Yeah, no, I don't think I want to do that. That is, no, no. Pass. As we look at verse 21, and the people said unto Joshua, nay, but we will serve the Lord. So they're like, no, man, come on, bro. No, we will serve the Lord. He's like, all right, now, all right, guys, I want y'all to think about what y'all saying now. I want y'all to think about that. This is a serious thing. Think about what y'all saying now. Think about what you're renewing right now. Listen, we know what we're renewing. We understand. Nay, we will serve the Lord. Okay. Again, as I said, these are receipts. These are the receipts that why are we going through this? God, well, you remember back when y'all said that y'all would serve me only? Well, what's that? 22. And Joshua said unto the people, ye are witnesses against yourselves that ye have chosen you, the Lord, to serve him. And they said, we are witnesses. Right. You all remember that campaign that they had for LeBron back in the day. Well, we're all witnesses. Right. Well, here in the case of the children of Israel, everybody that was there, all of the leaders of all of the tribes, he's like, all right, guys, you know, we need two or three people to confirm a thing. All of y'all are here. And here's a rock. Because he put a rock on top of the altar. He's like, here's the... Y'all, everyone heard, right? No one can go back and be like, yeah, man, I didn't say that. I didn't agree to that. I don't know what he's talking about. We are all witnesses. We all agree. We're going to serve the Lord only. We're not going to serve any idols. We're not going to do anything. We're not going to forsake him. None of that stuff. Okay. Y'all, all right. Let's look at 31. Excuse me, let's go back up in 21. This was the response, nay, but we will serve the Lord. This was the response Joshua wanted. A commitment, but made with full understanding of the consequences. So it's like, okay, y'all are saying, but we will serve, but I want y'all to understand the consequences if you don't. 23. Now therefore put away, said he, the strange gods which are among you, and incline your heart unto the Lord God of Israel. So he's like, okay, now y'all said y'all only going to serve the Lord. I know y'all serving idols, right? Don't think that we don't know that, right? So y'all need to go back home. You get rid of everything that's an idol. Get rid of it. Get it out the tribe. Get it out. Whatever you got to do, remove it. Because again, y'all just renewed. You all just re-upped the covenant with God. 24. And the people said to Joshua, unto Joshua, the Lord our God will we serve, and his voice we will obey. Now, that all sounds great. It does. And again, as I said, for that generation that was right after Joshua, right, when he passed, they followed the path. They stayed on the path. It's when they passed on, right, and that next generation came along that didn't go through the things that first generation went through, right, that you started to see where these words lost their value, right? Where you started to see them, oh man, let us, you know, we want to be like this. I'm not that. We want to be like these people. We want to be like the Philistines. We want to be like these. We want to be like the other Canaanites. No, we don't want a God as our king. We want a king. We all this, that, and the third. Again, here in this lesson, as Joshua is getting up in age, As a nation, they all said, the Lord our God will we serve, and his voice will we obey. Now, again, as I said, that should be for everyone, not just the children of Israel. Even today, as Christians, right? The Lord our God will we serve. We're not going to serve our money. We're not going to serve our cars. We're not going to serve our jobs. None of that. We will serve God, right? Again, practical point for those verses, promises of faithfulness to God must be backed up with concrete action. Again, promises of faithfulness to God must be backed up with concrete action. Listen, don't just say it, do it. Don't speak about it, be about it. As I say to my young people, walk that talk, right? We all say a lot of things out of our mouth, but we don't follow up with action. Or we make plans and we don't do anything to make the plan come to life. Again, you say, I belong to you, God. Well, you know what? You should have a prayer life. You should have a scripture life, right? You should spend time with the Lord and spend time with the fellow brothers and sisters. Your gifts should be ever growing stronger and stronger, right? You should be able to go out and give the gospel to the next person. There should be tangible signs that we can see after you've said, you know what, God, I want you to come into my life right now. I accept you. I accept you, Jesus. I don't want to be who I used to be, right? When we come back 6 months, a year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years later, 10 years later, you shouldn't still be the same. You shouldn't still be doing the same things and tripping over the same things that you were when you first came in. Again, promises of faithfulness to God must be backed up with concrete evidence or concrete action. Again, you got to study. You got to study to show yourself approved. You got to pray for yourself. Yes, there may be somebody interceding on your behalf and praying for you, but you can't guarantee that. You got to put in the work. I've already, as we are drawing this part one video to a close, I've already gone over the time that I wanted to go over, but I pray that this lesson was made plain, that you all take these practical points, that you apply them to your lives, that you, again, as we said in the opening, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You're not going to put anything in front of God. You're not going to promise something. You're not going to give yourself to God and then back away when it gets hot. You're going to remember what he did for you, how he brought you through, and you're going to stay loyal even when you're in the middle of the storm. So again, I look forward to seeing you all for part two, where we will dive into it a little bit further. Again, may you all have a great rest of your week. For those of you who do not know the pardoning of the of your sin, please, I would invite you to invite Christ into your life right now. Just again, all you have to do is believe that Christ came down. He stepped down. He took on the form of a slave. He died, right? He was raised from the grave. He's defeated sin, right? He is in heaven interceding on our behalf right now, right? Confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that he is alive, and ask him to come into your life right now and watch how heaven rejoices over you. Watch how he sends down the helpmate to seal in you. Again, today is a great day for the rest of your life, and I pray that you take that to heed. And again, I hope you guys have a great rest of your week. I look forward to seeing you all as we break down the lesson even further. Until then, everyone, God bless.